When you stray from the path of goodness, you're bound to pay for it someday. And let me tell you, God will always outweigh the evil. A glimpse to the vast glory of space. It's filled with shining stars. Stars that light the darkness in the void. But one star is different than all. One whose fate from the beginning was to shine the places that other stars couldn't reach. When it all began, hope was there. After the tournament, Goku and Vegeta got stronger. We thought that now their strength would protect their universe. But after some time, a new foe has arrived. One who's very different than everything that we've seen. He was called Moro. One who lived for thousands of years. He was special. He didn't use brute strength to beat his opponents. He absorbed their power and made it his own. When he came, Goku and Vegeta fought him multiple times. And each time that they fought him, the hope that was there was diminishing bit by bit. Till now, where they're still clinging to that hope. To the hope that they both will get strong enough to beat this foe. And this is what they did. Goku went off to train his ultra instinct. And Vegeta went on and trained on planet Namek. This is their last hope, the last string that they can pull. We ended the last chapter with Goku heading back to Earth and the Z fighters defending Earth while he's gone. And now the story will continue. Will hope be brought back for all of the living spirits in the universe? Will Goku be enough to defend Earth? And what's the Earth's fate until Goku arrives? This is chapter 57 of the Dragon Ball Super. The story continues on Earth, where the Z fighters, every one of them, is fighting Moro's henchmen. 17-18 Gohan, Piccolo, Krillin, Master Roshi, Tien, Chaozu, and Yamcha. And Moro from his ship is watching all of what's happening. On Dende's, Bulma has sent drones to watch the Z fighters in action. And the first one of them is Krillin. As he's fighting his opponent, he throws destructive discs at him. But his foe has his own tricks, as he deflects all of them and goes straight towards Krillin with a kick that knocks him down on the ground. He's smiling because he thinks that he's gotten him beaten. But Krillin isn't defeated yet. He puts his hand up and calls for the destructive disc that goes from behind his opponent and cuts him on his face. He then gets up, though badly beaten. He starts controlling all of the destructive discs, sending them towards Moro's henchmen. He evades them all and they go at Krillin. They hit him, but something's wrong. They go straight in him. He used an after image. As he gets behind his opponent, he says, "That's my after image move. Try to keep it in mind." He fires at him a ki blast from point blank. Krillin has done it. He has beaten him. He tells the Galactic Patrollers to take it from here. But before going, he hears a voice from behind him. It's Master Roshi, and it appears that he's doing his own thing. Krillin flies towards him. When he arrives, Master Roshi was sent flying. He says that these girls are more than he has bargained. And he wasn't fighting them. He was doing his own thing. He tries to disguise it as he can't hit his attacks, but we know what Master Roshi does in these situations. Now, he says that he got to focus as the three girls get out and faces them. Krillin notices that those girls actually have strong keys, but if Master Roshi uses the power that he used in the tournament of power, there wouldn't be much trouble. But he says that he needs to clear his mind, and we know what is on his mind at this point. On a different battlefield, Tien and Chaozu are fighting their own opponent. The middle guy that looks like the one from Universe 6. Tien's punches aren't doing anything to this guy. He's the one that actually getting hurt from his own punches. The Galactic Patrollers tell them that this guy is a member of a race of metal men, made entire out of metallic substance. He's just like Magita from Universe 6, and that guy had a weakness. Chaozu tells him, insult him, that's his weakness. Their fight continues. When Tien sees that there's no hope in a hand-to-hand combat, he goes for it and starts insulting him, calling him a rockhead. His insults are bad. He calls him, "You have ton tuppy." He needs to dig deeper or it will be too late. He doesn't know what counts as an insult against him. So Chaozu from behind him shouts, "Hey octopus." We see that the middle guy is getting insulted by that. He looks behind him and rages. He goes straight towards Chaozu. So Chaozu starts insulting him more, saying, "You have witted hunk of scrap metal." When he hears that, he's full of shock and collapses towards the ground. This is how they beat this guy. Tien's too nice. He doesn't know how to insult people, and well, Tien is a pure-hearted person after all. And to be honest, the way that the fight ended, I think it could have been better than that. Insulting some guy and the fight ends isn't something that I'm on board with. Back to another battlefield, it's Master Roshi. He covers his eyes so he can't see the girls as he's fighting the three of them at once. He's evading their attacks and winning against them all. He tells them, listen, when you stray for the path of goodness, you're bound to pay for it someday. So quit being all evil. Head back to that galactic prison and just be grateful there's a place where you get to alone. And wise words from the wisest man on earth. Wise words from Master Roshi. And he's right, when you stray from the path of goodness, you're bound to pay for it someday. The girls get angry, they're never going back to the prison. They all get ready to use their special move. They fuse and turn into a giant monster. Her power is immense. With one punch, she knocks Krillin back. Then she kicks Master Roshi, he goes through the woods, crashing. Her power is unbelievable. On Dende's, the Namekian notices something on Moore's ship. It's on the move as it goes down towards the ground. Moore and Sagampo jump down to the battlefield where 17 and 18 are fighting OG-73. They're beating him over and over as 17 goes on top of him, kicking him back. It's Moro, he grabs him. He's finally arrived and is grabbing the body of a beating OG-73. The Z fighters for the first time face this foe and see the one who has beaten Goku and Vegeta. He tells 73, I told you not to employ my ability so casually. He tells him, but we didn't stand a chance. Otherwise, Moore throws him and says, there will come a time when I require his power once more. Help him to recover. They take OG-73 back to the spaceship, but Moro and Sagambo are still there. Piccolo and Gohan are worried. Moro is on a whole different level. Gohan says, that's some horrifying key he's got. Like the death cries of countless people, it's pure evil. It's because he stole the energy from everyone he's killed. Moro says, it seems as though those two aren't here. Gohan tells him, they will be here. My dad and Vegeta are getting strong enough to beat you. So until then, protecting the earth is our job. You don't lack for boldness, but calm yourself. I'm in high spirits. This is what I was thinking. They can't protect earth from Moro. Gohan isn't strong enough. No one is strong enough to beat him. He has absorbed the power of Goku and Vegeta and a lot more planets. So what Gohan is gonna do, what Piccolo is gonna do, they need Goku and Vegeta. The reason that Moro is happy is that he has the good fortune of coming upon this planet. There aren't many out there teaming with so many high energy individuals. And he's right, there isn't too many in Universe 7. What a waste it would be to consume you all at once. How should I go about preparing this dish? He's so confident in himself, he reminds me of the first time that Beerus arrived. And look at him now, he's not that confident in himself anymore. Sagambo comes from behind Moro and tells him that he wants to cook this once to Moro's liking. He wants to be the one that prepares them for Moro, which Moro agrees to. But he wants them alive to snack on their energy, but not without a gift from Moro, as he zaps him with energy, which transforms Sagambo to a more powerful version of himself. When Moro gives him the green light, Sagambo flies towards them all, punching 17 back. 18 tries to hold him, and then all of the Z fighters try to hold Sagambo back, but they're not enough. As he spins them all at once, he grabs 17 and Gohan and slams them to the ground, rendering them conscience. And this is what I'm saying, they can't even beat Sagambo with a bit of Moro's power. So how will they beat Moro on a different side of Earth? Master Roshi and Krillin are hiding from the fused girls. They know that they're gonna lose, but Krillin isn't going down without a fight. Krillin says, I sure hope you notice the last burst of power and come running, buddy. He wants Goku to notice him. He knows that he's not gonna make it, so he hopes that by some miracle Goku will notice his ki and teleport to him. This is the hope that I've been talking about. And far, far off in space, we see Goku's ship. Goku is heading towards Earth. He starts noticing the keys of the ones on it, of Tien, Gohan. Everyone is getting beaten, but he can't instant transmission to them because he can barely feel their key. As he tries more and more and more, he locates Krillin's key. Then he locates Earth. As the fusion between the girls goes flying towards Krillin, he stands there. He knows that he's not gonna make it, but he stands there ready to fight, knowing that he will lose. But the girls get hit by an attack, sending them flying back and rendering them unconscious. It's Goku. He has arrived on Earth. He says with a smile, "Sorry, I got a habit of showing up late." Krillin. In my opinion, this scene of Krillin hoping for Goku to come to Earth, of him not knowing if Goku can actually sense his ki, his hope that Goku will arrive in time to save him, to save his planet, and then actually Goku coming to the planet and saving Krillin is a heartwarming scene. A friend having hope in his friend. Krillin having hope in Goku that he will arrive on Earth to save them from war. And this is why we should have faith in Goku. This is the story of how Goku will make the universe shine once more. The story of chapter 57 of the Dragon Ball Super manga. There's no bad deed that goes unpunished. There's no evil person who can do his evil acts over and over and over without one day facing the good that can never be faced. That someone called Goku, the most pure-hearted person that there is, one of the strongest beings in Universe 7, and the glimmer of light in all the darkness. This was the story of the struggle of the Z fighters on Earth, of how you should never lose hope in the ones that you trust, because those ones will be there by your side, no matter what. You should always have hope in them, because if we lost hope, we lose ourselves. This was the story of how Goku will bring hope back to Earth. Thank you for watching, and saying that, I will see you on the next one. Bye bye.